Stephen Godana here at the new Top Velocity Science Series, where we go out and do the hard work for you, and we bring you the latest science on high velocity pitching. And we've done that for you today. We're up here in our research and development department, in our lab coats with our professional science gear that we got at Party City. And we are going to take and start with one of the best studies you will find from 2014 called Kinematic and Kinetic Profiles of Trunk, Lower Limbs During Baseball Pitching in Collegiate Pitchers. Why did I pick this study? Because it really helps us understand the lower legs. It helps us understand kinematics and kinetics. That means the forces and torques and angles and movements and how that drives the upper body, the trunk movements. And this study, they said that was their purpose of the study, because there wasn't really conclusive evidence of what was really going on down there to create the forces in the body and to move the trunk and create all the good angles in the body. And it helps us to understand it between a high velocity and low velocity group. So talk about the methods. How did they create these high velocity groups, and what are the details?
So they took 30 collegiate level pitchers, 25 of them right-handed, 5 of them left-handed pitchers. They broke them up into two groups, the high velocity group and the low velocity group. The high velocity group was 84 miles per hour and above. The low velocity group was 76 miles per hour and below. Unfortunately, we do not have studies where they're getting 90 mile per hour pitchers. Why don't they get 90 mile per hour pitchers? I don't understand it.
They just don't do it. But this study said that it's comparable to all the other studies that have been put out on the lower limbs and the trunk. These velocities are comparable, and in some cases even better.
Okay.
So we don't have to think that this is the only study with the low velocities. These are the velocities they typically use. They haven't found the 90 mile an hour guys yet. I don't know where they are.
They're unicorns.
They're here at top velocity.
Yeah, absolutely.
They're here. So now that we understand the method, let's look at how they break it down, so you can better understand how they're defining the pitching delivery. So they have two phases, just like we do three X pitch velocity program. We call their phase one, we call it our stride phase, they just call it phase one. Phase two, we call it the throwing phase, they call it phase two. Within there, there's some components, a little snapshots of delivery. We've got what they call MKH, maximum knee height. They call MAP, maximum anterior push, push off. SFC, stride foot contact. MER, maximum external rotation. And REL, release. All right, that's just how they're gonna break it down, and that's gonna help you understand what's going on when we look at the results. Also, when they start talking about hip movements, we need to understand that when the femur kicks out to the side, that's abduction. When it comes back, it's adduction. When the femur rotates in socket, rotates inwards, internal rotation, outwards, external rotation. When it moves up and back, that's flexion, extension. Dorsiflexion, plantar flexion, that's the ankle coming up, going down. Forward trunk tilts, the trunk going forward. Knee extensions is going to be, and inflection is going to be defined in that front knee. So now let's look quickly at the results, and then we'll give you our interpretation.
Table 2 shows descriptive data on the lower limb kinematics and the temporal parameters. Pivot, hip, abduction angles at maximum external rotation and stride foot contact were significantly smaller in the high velocity group than in the low velocity group. Stride knee extension angle at release, stride knee extension angular velocity at maximum external rotation and release, and maximum stride knee extension angular velocity were significantly greater in the high velocity group than in the low velocity group. Table 3 shows a comparison between the two groups in terms of the trunk kinematics and temporal parameters. Upper trunk angle at release and forward trunk tilt angles at maximum anterior push, maximum external rotation and release were significantly greater in the high velocity group than in the low velocity group. The maxima of the upper torso, pelvis, trunk, positive twist, and trunk negative twist angular velocities, upper torso and trunk twist angular velocities at maximum external rotation, and forward trunk tilt angular velocity at stride foot contact were significantly greater in the high velocity group than in the low velocity group. Table 4 shows descriptive data on ground reaction forces data and temporal parameters. Force Y on the pivot leg at maximum anterior push and force X on the stride leg at maximum external rotation were significantly greater in the high velocity group than in the low velocity group. Force Y and force Z and resultant forces on the stride leg at maximum external rotation and release for the high velocity group were significantly greater than those for the low velocity group. the maxima of force Y and resultant forces, and minima of force X force on the pivot leg were significantly greater in the high velocity group than in the low velocity group. The maxima of force X, force Y, force Z, and resultant forces, and minima of force Y force on the stride leg significantly greater in the high velocity group than in the low velocity group. Maximum force Z and resultant forces on the stride leg occur just prior to release, with a significantly later occurrence in the high velocity group than in the low velocity group. Table 5 shows a comparison between the high velocity group and the low velocity group in terms of the joint torques of lower limbs and their temporal parameters. The joint torques of pivot hip abduction, pivot hip internal rotation, and pivot knee extension at maximum anterior push, and stride hip abduction at stride foot contact were significantly greater in the high velocity group than in the low velocity group. The maxima of pivot hip abduction, pivot hip internal rotation, pivot hip flexion, and pivot knee extension torques were significantly greater in the high velocity group than in the low velocity group.
All right, Stu, if we still got you, we'll give it to you in layman's terms, or how we really interpret this data. So basically what we're finding is that the drive leg has a significant role in generating force production and building torques into the hip going into front foot strike. I'm not gonna speculate or go into other studies that help us better understand that, we will in other episodes, but for you to know that this, just to understand the difference between a high velocity and low velocity pitcher, is that a high velocity pitcher is going to generate more force out of the back leg, and he's going to put more torques in the hips and knee. At front foot strike, we're going to have high velocity guys also with more forces in the front leg and more torques in that hip. That, the goal of that and the timing of that, is to create bigger trunk dynamics in tilts going forward, trunk tilts going forward, or loading to back going forward, and then counter rotation, and then rotation to the plate. So we want a more dynamic trunk, and how we do that is generating those torques and forces in the lower half. Why don't you give them some of the things that we do, the 3X pitching velocity program, to help train these correlations or the things that these high velocity pitchers are doing to throw harder? What do we do to train them?
We use the King of the Hill plate to train force production from the back leg drive and the front leg extension. Then we bring in the 2-pound med ball to learn how to transfer the force production from the lower half into the trunk to create a more dynamic trunk. By doing that, we take the 2-pound med ball, which limits us to be able to get full external rotation with the arm that you would get with a regular baseball, and teaches you to learn how to use the trunk more to create the velocity.
Right, and then we take the baseballs finally, and then we work on the arm path and the arm dynamics and make sure that the trunk dynamics that were trained so well with the 2-pound med ball are still driving the arm path when we get to the baseballs. And that way, we are able to take advantage of every single one of these components that link to high velocity pitchers. Forces and torques in the back leg with the King of the Hill plates and our 3X drive drills, torques and forces in the front leg with the King of the Hill plates and our 2X drive throws, the 2-pound med ball throws, which mimic the pitching delivery, but don't allow us to overcompensate with the arm movements, to become more dynamic with the trunk, still using those forces that we were learning to move that, and then finally bringing in the baseballs to then allow the arm movements to come in, making sure that they are just a product of the forces and torques and angles moving up the kinetic chain. All right, so simple as that, right? If you have any questions, any questions about the study, or if you'd like to read more about the study, it is a public study. This one is out there. I'll link it to the video. You can go out and read it. You can start a conversation here, start a debate with us. We would love it. I think this is an excellent study. This is a study that you need to spend more time reading. Get into the discussions and the conclusions on it. Really, really great information, high-level information. I'd say you get it to your coach, your private coach, and maybe your team coach, because this is information that needs to get out. And that's why we do the Top Velocity Science series, is to get this high level information out to you to make you a better pitcher.